Welcome to another episode of Forbidden TV, and in this episode we visit the Monastery of the Magic Mushroom. Now, in this episode, we begin our investigation into the magic mushroom cults of Europe. And we've come to Périgord, which officially is part of France. But in actual fact, this is a nation called Occitania. They have their own flag, they have their own national language, which is Occitanian. And what happened is that the landlords, the land barons, and the kings and queens of France and Spain kind of gobbled up Occitania. It still exists in terms of its own language, which the local people here speak. But what we can see in the hills behind me is a very, very fascinating phenomenon. And that is that there are still people living in caves here. And these exact same caves were occupied by ancient prehistoric people 23,000 BC. What they painted on the walls of these caves is very fascinating. We see depictions of prehistoric horses, of bison, buffalo-type creatures. But when we really look closely, we can see that there are black dots painted with ochre and charcoal, and these dots have now been analysed by archaeologists who believe that these are showing the phases of the moon. Not only that, but we can see that the bulls and the horns of the bulls that are painted on these ancient prehistoric caves, they actually correspond with the shapes of star constellations. So these are not just murals of the animals which prehistoric man was hunting. They are, in actual fact, murals which are star maps from 23,000 BC. Thousands of years ago, complex technology which bridged the gap between the physical world and the spiritual world was developed in Iraq, Egypt, Mexico, and European megalithic sites such as Stonehenge. Buried deep inside sacred mounds of earth in Göbekli Tepe in Turkey, in Egypt, in Iran, and Iraq, and also buried deep under the pyramids of Mexico, we have discovered statues of very strange demons. Alongside these statues are other artifacts which resemble the components of electrical circuits, such as the Jed pillar, which looks suspiciously very similar to a Tesla coil. In the ancient world, electricity was being generated using batteries filled with acid vinegar. And these devices created a flowing energy which was used by the Illuminati royal families of ancient Egypt, ancient Iraq, ancient Britain, and ancient Mexico to make psychic contact with spirits, angels, and demons. These devices, in turn, inspired the greatest scientists of the modern world, some of whom were members of secret societies which hosted seances in which ectoplasm and technological apparatus were used to show us images of the spirit world. All this technology was kept utterly secret. Welcome to the world of forbidden electrical psychic spiritual technology. Welcome to the world of forbidden TV. My name is Chris Everard, and I travel the world investigating psychic, spiritual, and technological secrets which the ruling elite have kept secret for thousands and thousands of years. In this episode, we take to the skies of Egypt with the DJI Inspire Super Drone. We use 4K stereoscopic cameras and a special contrast and laser scanning app from Adobe to reveal secret chambers inside the pyramids of Giza. We reconstruct brand new 3D models of the Great Pyramid from our 4K super resolution images, and for the first time ever on film, can confirm that the Great Pyramid is actually a honeycomb structure with many more niches, nooks, and small chambers than previously thought. We also journey deep into the King's Chamber and reveal for the first time on camera its secret second entrance, and also show you a trapdoor in the floor of the King's Chamber, which reveals that part of the floor is actually hollow. And we also investigate how vocal chanting inside the King's Chamber reveals resonant frequencies that sound like some ghost voice is singing back at you. We go deep into the Great Pyramid and show you the doorways to many secret chambers. Inside the King's Chamber, we conduct experiments with chanting and acoustics, and we reveal the so-called hidden voice of the King's Chamber, which is its sacred resonant frequency known as Om. And also in this episode, we explore underneath the catacombs of the Vatican in Rome and discover the Pope's most holy relic, which shows St. Peter in the form of a hallucinogenic mushroom. Giza, Egypt. This plateau is where a large number of megalithic Greco-Roman, Macedonian, and Egyptian pyramids, temples, lodges, chapels, and monuments to the gods have been built over thousands of years. We already know about shafts and tunnels and chambers inside most of the Egyptian pyramids. But new imaging, high contrast technologies, and the use of GoPro Session 5 cameras have enabled us to laser map new 3D models of all the Giza pyramids. Our 3D models are based on high contrast images from the DJI Inspire Super Drone. By raising the threshold luminosity of our images, we end up with a much simplified image of each Giza pyramid. This high resolution, simplified image allows us to see indentations, nooks, niches, and even small cavities in the structure of the Giza pyramids.
by mapping just the contour and shape of individual stone blocks, we can see many niches and small chambers close to the exterior surface of each of the Giza pyramids. So join us now on an epic voyage of discovery as we also explore the bizarre acoustic cymatic properties inside the King's Chamber of the Great Pyramid.
In the modern world, ancient Egypt is absolutely crawling with tourists. And the tourists don't really realize that hallucinogenic plants were very much part of the magical ceremonies and rituals used by the priesthoods who served the pharaohs. Now, one of these most important drugs, if you like, was opium. Opium is made from poppies. It's the actual juice which exudes from the poppy head and is scraped up, and it's allowed to dry into a kind of gummy paste and is then burnt. What is amazing is that here at Karnak, we see pharaohs, kings, and queens with opium pipes. And their opium pipes very much resemble the types of pipes which we normally associate with the Oriental world, such as the opium dens of Victorian Hong Kong. And in some of these carvings and murals, we see the kings offering the smoke of opium to their gods. And what I believe is that the smoke from this opium incense was the medium into which the spirits of certain angels and demons and gods would appear. And in the mind's eye of the magician, they would see forms within the smoke plumes of the opium incense, and priests would chant.
We now go inside the Great Pyramid of Giza, and in this part of the show we're going to investigate the various secret chambers and doorways and film them for the very first time using 4K high resolution cameras. And we start off in the King's Chamber of the Great Pyramid of Cheops.
In the right-hand corner behind the sarcophagus, there is this trap door. It's about 4.5 feet long. It's about 1.5 feet wide. There is a hole which shows that there is a cavern underneath the floor. And the last time I was in the Great Pyramid, I met an official engineer from the Department of Antiquities. And he told me that there has been a geophysics survey 3 times of this particular area of the King's Chamber, once in 1990, once in 2000, and once in 2010. And there is a small tunnel extending out from the floor, just below the floor of the King's Chamber, at an angle to the corner. And it extends out about 8 to 10 feet. And this official engineer, his name was Mohammed, told me that the tunnel ends in a dead end. And the question is this: why is the floor of the King's Chamber built in such a way that there can be a cavity underneath it with a tunnel extending out from the corner? That's just one of the typical mysteries of this King's Chamber. Also, above the actual trapdoor, there is an extended corner joint, and it looks as if the corner block to the back of the sarcophagus actually has been cut into a slight curve.
so that the corner is actually curved within the actual block itself, rather than just two blocks joining each other as you would have in normal masonry. The other corner behind the sarcophagus is yet another place which tourists rarely look at. And an Egyptologist called J.P. Lepre made it clear that in 1990 there was an extremely wide joint between two blocks. This is in the left-hand corner of the King's Chamber behind the sarcophagus. I interviewed an archaeologist from the Egyptian Department of Antiquities second to last time I was here in the King's Chamber, and he said that this joint had been the subject of some restoration work. And if we look at this, it's very clear that someone at some time in the recent past has hacked and chipped and chiseled their way through this joint. And in Alan Alford's book, Pyramid of Secrets, and also in the journals of an Egyptologist called J.P. Lepre, we know that there's been suspicions about this particular block, and people have said that this could be a secret entrance to the King's Chamber. At the moment, it seems to have been filled in with cement, but we know that there's been lies, cover-ups, and corruption amongst some of the officials of the old Egyptian antiquities regime, and thankfully those people have now been replaced and removed. One can only assume that this block was once removed and there was an excavation behind it. And the reason that I assume that is because for a very long time, in recent years, the public have been stopped from entering the King's Chamber. Above this block, there is another very, very big seam that's been hacked and chipped and chiseled away. And that again suggests that this back left-hand corner of the King's Chamber behind the sarcophagus has been really excavated and examined, but it hasn't been publicized, and that this could be an alternative entrance, or it could be a doorway to yet another chamber inside the Great Pyramid. That's called the pyramid effect. No kidding. Cameras and audio recorders and anything electronic go very, very strange. The base of this sarcophagus is not level. There are lots of, lots and lots of people who come from all over the world to make voice and sound experiments inside the King's Chamber. And very often they lay down inside this sarcophagus and they do chanting and other kinds of ad-libbed sounds. And inside this sarcophagus, over the last few visits, we found gemstones and little crystals that have been left here by various people. The combination of having a pure solid granite block that's been hollowed out, which has then been placed inside this chamber, which is itself made of 100 rose granite blocks, and we know for sure that parts of the floor of the King's Chamber are actually hollow, has created this incredible acoustic chamber. The ancient world is full of incantations and spells, chantings and weird vocal manipulations. And people in the priesthoods of ancient Egypt used to call out the names of their gods in spiritual invocations. Now it seems that the resonant frequency is somewhere around the typical chanting frequency that you find in India, and that is usually what we call the Om, the sacred sound of Om. So a mid-tone doesn't really have that much resonance, but if you try a lower tone typical of what's used on the Indian subcontinent, you actually get more of a resonant tone. The typical Om sound is the resonant frequency of this chamber. I'll try it once more.
Journey back into a time way before the pharaohs of ancient Egypt. We journey back into the prehistory of mankind, when the landscape itself was worshipped, and the stars were worshipped, and the planets were not really known by ancient man. The actual stars themselves were given different personalities by ancient man, and this is known as archaeoastronomy. Ancient man decided to actually place standing stones into the landscape, which were mapped out and arranged to mimic the arrangement of stars in the night sky. Rock formations, mountains, and volcanoes themselves were actually worshipped as if they were gods. Every great religion started out as a small, crazy cult. Some of these cults worshipped plants, and they even worshipped mushrooms. Way back in the Stone Age history of mankind, we somehow discovered that telepathy could be enhanced using psychedelic plants. At Shinar in ancient Iraq, Stone Age people grew gardens of ephedra. Ephedra is like a Stone Age version of cocaine. They also grew vines of the morning glory plant. And the tendrils of morning glory ended up being featured as a motif on one of the royal crowns of ancient Egypt. But it is far more than just telepathy which drove ancient mankind to cultivate psychedelic plants. In the Sahara of Algeria and Libya, a great mushroom god existed. They drew his image on the wadis of Algeria. In fact, these mushroom-munching mystics actually used dried psychedelic mushrooms as a form of money. In fact, henbane seeds, thorn apple, opium poppy seeds, and amanita mushrooms all became used as a form of currency in the ancient world. The iconography of the magic mushroom has actually inspired the ceremonial robes of many religions, especially Catholicism. Périgord in France is where we find prehistoric caves. 22,000 years ago, ancient man drew lunar phase diagrams using charcoal and traded psychedelic mushrooms like a form of money. When Christianity finally came to Périgord, the ancient mushroom cult of France amalgamated images of hallucinogenic mushrooms with crucifixes. As Christianity swept across the world, the ancient mushroom cults equated the legend of the Holy Spirit with the feeling of euphoria one gets from eating magic mushrooms. Psychedelia is the most in-depth investigation into the kings and queens of the ancient world. It's a book which is far more than just about drugs in the ancient world. It proves that the richest families who ever walked the face of the planet gained their riches by dealing in opium, cocaine, hashish, and tobacco. Stone Age Psychedelia proves that the psychedelic experience is at the root of all religions. Stone Age Psychedelia is available exclusively with a free DVD documentary film from ChristopherEverard.com and also from ChristopherEverard.co.uk. These plants and these mushrooms connected mankind with the Mother Goddess, what we today call Mother Nature. But it was not just the Mother Nature Goddess spirit who was contacted during psychedelic rituals. Ancient man also contacted angels and spirits and elders from their own villages and from their own communities. This was the beginning of the world's great religions. From the Himalayas, where temple ball hashish was made, to the deserts of Mexico and the deserts of Arizona, where mushrooms were cultivated by the Huaca and the Anasazi, we know that the root of all great religions is seated into the world of psychedelic plants. Stone Age Psychedelia is a 308-page book with a full index, and it has full-color illustrations. It goes way beyond introducing you to the types of plants and funguses that were used to get the psychedelic experience in the ancient world. Stone Age Psychedelia also takes you into the spirit world and introduces you to all of the different types of plant teachers and plant spirits that have been reported by shamans and mystics throughout the ages. There is a longer, more in-depth version available on the Enigma channel. The Enigma channel is like WikiLeaks, but instead of reading documents about secret subjects, you can put your feet up and watch thousands of fascinating documentary films covering subjects which have been censored and suppressed from the mainstream media for decades. The Enigma channel is a 100% independent TV network with documentaries and TV shows which are not available on YouTube, not on Netflix, and are unique to the Enigma channel. If you would like to join one of our filming crews and go on an expedition to the ancient world, then you need to visit the Enigma Channel website. That's enigmachannel.com, or you can visit the members site at enigmatv.com. Use the contact form and write the word expedition in the subject heading. In exchange for a small contribution towards our filming costs, you will actually become a member of our crew. You'll be eating with us in the same hotels, you'll be traveling with us, you'll be meeting all of the authors and people which we interview. Now, every year, we are filming at amazing museums in places like Athens, Paris, Madrid, Barcelona, New York, Mexico, Egypt, you name it. You'll get to stay in haunted castles. You can visit haunted pubs. You can be taken on moonlit walks around London. And we visit many, many ancient cities. Our expeditions include lectures about things like Nostradamus, the Cathars, the Illuminati, Nikola Tesla, the Vatican, paranormal research. Believe me, it's a lot of fun. So what you do is you contact us via the Enigma Channel websites. It's enigmachannel.com or enigmatv.com. And we look forward to meeting you and look forward to inviting you as a member of our filming crew. Enigma Channel is rather like WikiLeaks, except instead of reading documents about secret subjects, you'll be watching documentary films. There are literally thousands of hard-to-find TV shows and video files which were deleted from public sharing video sites years ago, all on the Enigma Channel. It's an amazing library of knowledge. And top researchers and top authors upload their videos to the Enigma Channel first before they upload them to social media and social video sharing websites. Signing up for an account takes less than 2 minutes. It's just a small donation once a year, and that is a gateway for you to have uncensored information and professionally made HD documentaries every single day of the week. Go to enigmatv.com or our members site, enigmachannel.com. The Garden of Eden had a tree with forbidden fruit. Forbidden, that is, unless you were a person who wished to gain knowledge. The Greek word for knowledge is gnosis, and this is a code word for the hallucinogenic messages which come from the spirit world. The Vatican Library in Rome is closed to the public. Inside, it has one of the largest collections of manuscripts authored by monks and nuns worldwide. Now, for 350 years, The Murano Jews, who are known as the Conversos, they were running the Inquisition of the Vatican. And what they were doing is they were hunting down witches and sorcerers in Europe. And the reason they were doing that is because they wanted a monopoly on the summoning of these weird demons. And all these creatures that you see in these illuminated manuscripts in various cathedrals and Catholic libraries around Europe, these weird creatures are actually representing the demons of the Goetia and the demons of the grimoires, which were written and authored by King Solomon. And the Vatican and the Inquisition wanted a complete monopoly on the summoning of these weird devils, demons, and nasty psychic creatures. The Vatican Library not only includes illustrations of demons from hell, but it also reveals the secret that the early Christian church was very much influenced by psychedelic mushrooms. These illuminated manuscripts are full of hallucinogenic images, hardly none of which have anything to do with the traditional Bible story. In fact, the Vatican have been keeping a very big secret, and that is that the first early Christian churches of Greece, Turkey, Syria, Palestine, and Egypt were all based on a cult of mushroom-munching mystics. This is the Basilica de Aquileia near Collimaggio in Italy. It's not far from the Adriatic Sea. This was the very first place that I researched when I started writing my book Stone Age Psychedelia. And this mosaic floor had actually been covered up deliberately because it gave away one of the biggest secrets of the Catholic Church, and that is that the early congregations actually fed psychedelic mushrooms, which they collected from the nearby woodlands, to snails, and then they would cook and eat the snails. The advantage of this is that some of the unwanted effects of delirium that you get from some of the amanitas would be absorbed into the snails, and then by eating the snails you would just get the hallucinogenic effects. And then Hildesheim in Germany is also another very interesting place that has very old reproductions of these scenes from the Garden of Eden. You have God Almighty himself giving commands there to Adam and Eve, and you can clearly see that the tree in the center of the Garden of Eden, which has the forbidden fruit, is itself a psychedelic mushroom. And the popes and cardinals even dress up as if they are the holy mushroom itself. Now, the Amanita muscaria mushroom actually begins life as a small sphere, which then grows into an egg shape. And all of the stages of the life cycle of an Amanita muscaria, fly agaric hallucinogenic mushroom, has been kind of amalgamated into the dress sense of the Vatican. These are all the cardinals. These are the top dudes. And as you can see, they wear the frilly lace, and that obviously represents the frilled remnants of the cocoon of the canopy of the mushroom. And then the Greek Orthodox Church, they wear mushroom shaped crowns. Also, the Roman of royal family wore mushroom shaped crowns. Now, this is the Amanita muscaria as it first emerges from the ground. It's an egg, and then the egg breaks free and a stem comes from it. Well, this is exactly what you find in the creation myths of ancient Egypt. The creation myths from the Temple of Unas say that there was an egg and then a flower came from the egg. And this shape here, when the canopy first develops, you can clearly see that this is represented in ancient Egyptian iconography. And unfortunately, you know, there's people who organize these trips to Egypt and they know nothing at all about the spiritual telepathy of the actual Egyptian brotherhoods and priesthoods. And what we're left with today is really just basically the iconographic remnants of this mushroom cult. Are the Vatican, you know, still taking Amanita muscaria in special cliques and covens? Probably they are. Probably they are. And it's probably taking place down in the catacombs of the Vatican, where I was amazed to see that the most holy part of the Vatican, which is underground, it's called the Confessio, actually has a cross which is inverted, which is, you know, a symbol which I usually associate with Satanism. And I was pretty amazed to see that just recently broadcast on the TV news. The so-called Holy Spirit is a mistranslation of the original Bible scripture. It should be called the Spirit of Holiness, and this term is used to describe the elated psychic experience which is created when drinking the sacred soma juice of hallucinogenic mushrooms. The halo and aura depicted in ancient Christian paintings is actually the underneath of the Amanita fly agaric mushroom. Thousands of years, the shamans of Siberia have used psychoactive Amanita muscaria mushrooms, which are also known as fly agaric mushrooms. And these mushrooms assist their contact with the spirit world. Fly agaric was used in Pakistan, where the Rig Veda, one of the oldest religious scriptures known to mankind, predating the New Testament by at least 1,000 years, contains a series of verses praising and even worshipping a divine drink called soma. Mm-hmm. Soma is made from the juice of Amanita muscaria mushrooms mixed with milk. This magical and highly hallucinogenic soma milk inspired the Babas, the Sufis, early pre-Islamic mystics. It inspired Hinduism, it inspired Sikhism, and all the mystical religions of the Himalayas. But more than this, it is Christianity, more than any other ancient cult, which has been inspired by the psychic effect of the fly agaric mushroom.
Uriel Seraphim.
Uriel Seraphim.
Io Podesta.
Zati Zata.
Galatim Galata.
Galatim Galata.
Thank you very, very much for watching this episode. And if you head over to the official website, which is forbiddentv.net, you'll be able to download X-rated late-night versions of this show, which investigate voodoo and Jack the Ripper. And you can also visit the Enigma channel and get a subscription and watch literally thousands and thousands of documentaries like this that I've produced over the years. My name is Chris Everard. Thank you for watching. I'll see you in the next episode, and we are going to be visiting Iran, Syria, Tibet, Nepal, India, Spain, France, and Germany in the upcoming episodes. See you then. Yeah.